به نام نگارنده دفتر هستی. In the name of the author of the Book of Existence, it's a great pleasure for me to be able to deliver the first lecture in the activities of this new organization. I always say, if you ever, I was lecturing one of the mosques in Isfahan, we would not need these gadgets, the acoustics would work by itself. This first lecture that has been arranged in this new program of the Iran Foundation, it's a great pleasure for me to be able to present it to you. Before beginning, I want to just say a word in Persian to greet my countrymen and women who are here for the new year. My tongue doesn't turn around to say it in English so easily. میخواستم عید سعید نوروز رو خدمت همتون تبریک بگم. یاد مادون نره که نوروز یعنی روز نوست، یعنی در واقع احیای حیات، احیای زندگی ما، احیای اون مطلبی که امروز من در سخنرانی با سرکار خواهم داشت، یعنی احیای حیات. و انشالله که برای همتون سالی پر از توفیق، سلامتی، شادی باشه و برای ملت ایران و همه مردم ایران سال خوبی باشه. I'm sorry I said that in Persian, the rest of it will be in English, but not all of it. I'm going to quote a few poems also of Rumi in Persian, for those of you who do not know Persian, in order to get the musicality of the poems of this remarkable man, Jalaluddin Rumi. And we begin with a very famous poem of his that in a sense is related very much to the theme about which I'm going to speak, as the poem that many people know. It says, مرده بودم، زنده شدم، گریه بودم، خنده شدم، دولت عشق آمد و من دولت پاینده شدم. All the translations I make of Rumi are my own translations tonight, which nobody can translate these poems, but to the extent that is possible, which I would translate as, I was dead, I became quickened, quickened in the old English sense of brought back to life, quickened. I was tears, I became laughter. The dominion of love came, and I became the enduring dominion. Of course, the word dolat can be translated in many ways, but I think here it goes with the word dominion. That is, when love comes, one enters into the eternal presence, which never disappears. From the point of view of this remarkable sage, and from the point of view of wisdom itself, most human beings think they are alive, but they're really dead, because our heart is dead. And to live in this world is to try to bring our heart back to life. We need to learn to live, and that living is only possible if our heart once again reverberates in the rhythm of the eternal life for which it was created. And so the goal of a great master like Rumi, he was not a poet, he was not a cultural icon of Iran, these are secondary or of Turkey. He was one of the greatest sages who ever lived, a mystic, a philosopher, a spiritual being of the highest order. The goal of all of his writings, of all his activities, not only his music, his poetry, but also his music, was precisely to bring us back to life, to renew our life, to make us be alive instead of being dead. As he said in this poem, مرده بودم زنده شدم. I was dead and I became alive. So I want to concentrate in the few minutes I have with you about this aspect of Rumi. Let me ask first of all the question, why is it that Rumi has become so popular? This is both a boon, a blessing, and a tragedy, because usually when things become popular, they also lose their essence and their genuineness most of the time. I always say that this is very interesting, that there's a word which is spelled the same way in French and English, the word vulgarization, which in French is vulgarisation, and in French it means to popularize, in English it means to vulgarize. And the French meaning oftentimes leads to the English meaning, unfortunately. And the very popularity of Rumi has been actually an uprooting of him in many circles from the spiritual ground from which he arose, and the power of the message that he has for those who are able to understand it. But it's a very important question, nevertheless, why it is of all these different great poets, philosophers, this man has become so famous during the last few decades. Why is it that when Arbery and Nicholson, and before them Brown and Winfield and these great English scholars first translated Rumi from the 1890s until about the 1930s, was only read by a number of elite scholars at Cambridge or Oxford or someplace like that. It was not popular. Why is it that suddenly he's become the most popular poet of the English language in America? More of his books are read sold in poetry than sonnets of Shakespeare and John Keats, the two greatest poets in the English language, probably. It's really quite an amazing fact. And this leads us actually to a need, to understand a need that exists today in the souls of many people for what Rumi has to say. Alas, that much of this is distorted, diluted. I always say jokingly, it's as if you took a lemon and squeezed it into a pool of water. Yes, that's lemonade, but it's pretty dilute. And much of the Rumi that we get in the United States is that one lemon squeezed into a pool of water. But nevertheless, the fact that there is so much interest in Rumi points to something very, very important. Let me mention some of these points. First of all, there is no parochialism in Rumi. We live in a world in which we talk about internationalism, but we are bound in the worst way to a form of tribalism which determines everything that we do. We call it nationalism. When we say the international community, that means usually the United States and England. The rest of the world, of course, don't count. We really have no international appreciation of things, politically and otherwise. We talk about it a great deal. We have become a contrast to the apparent globalization, extension of boundaries beyond our country, awareness through television of the rest of the world and all of this. In contrast to that, we become more and more parochial in many ways, much more than many human beings have been over the ages. And so parochialism is one of the maladies, one of the great maladies of the world today. And it's very difficult for many people to strike a balance between the love of one's culture and parochialism, which is not exactly the same thing. Poor Rumi, of course, has had his share in this suffering, first of all, for over 100 years since the rise of nationalism in the Islamic world. Turkey and Iran have fought over Rumi, whether it was a Persian or a Turk. And or not, the Afghans have come in also. Afghanistan and Iran, the same country, but British geographers decided otherwise in the 19th century, now we have two countries. But that's the same culture, really. But the idea that he was an Afghan or Persian or Turk, but especially between the Persian and the Turks, has really done very little service. In fact, granted a disservice to the understanding of Rumi. I know a lot of Persian countrymen of mine who understand nothing of Rumi. But they will get into a fight over dinner that Rumi was a Persian and not a Turk. They're not interested in reading two poems of his. But that part, the thing is part of their nationalistic identity. That is total nonsense from the point of view of what Rumi stands for. Yes, he was a Persian. There's no doubt about it. He wrote 60,000 verses of poetry in Persian, about 200 in Turkish, and about a dozen in Greek. The three languages in which he wrote. Local Greek of Anatolia, which had not disappeared at the time when Rumi lived in the 7th Islamic century. And he wrote some things in Arabic, of course, like the beginning of the Masnavi. But at the same time, he lived the last 40 years of his life in Turkey. And he died in Konya. And his tomb is the spiritual center of Turkey to this very, very day. And it plays a very significant role. Sufi order that he founded, the Maulavi order, never took roots in Iran or Afghanistan. It spread throughout the Ottoman world and Ottoman provinces, and the provinces like Syria, and Lebanon, where there's still the remnants of the old tekkes or Sufi centers of Maulana. So this is the reality of the situation. But he himself, his message was not really for only one people. It was not only for certainly not one nationality. And he cannot be used as an emblem for modern nationalism, which has done so much to bring discord to much of the world, and especially the Islamic world. We're at a moment when Europe is trying to forget this horrible Frankenstein that he dreamt of in form of modern nationalism, is trying to surmount it. They would go to war to prevent Kuwait from joining another country, to preserve nationalism in the Islamic world in such a way as to segment and cut the world in half. So in such a situation, the message of Rumi must be understood, not at all in a nationalistic sense. I want to quote for you a poem, a very, very famous poem of Rumi, one of his most famous ghazals. And it's the only long poem of his I will quote for you, because it's also musically one of the most beautiful. This ghazal was considered by Nicholson to be part of the Divan, the Grand Divan, and so did the Persian editors felt the same. Some people feel it's attributed to Rumi, but perhaps written by one of his disciples, following the master's voice. But whatever it is, it's really Rumi at the highest level, and it has remarkable musicality, which all of the poems of Rumi, especially the Divan, has. The Persian classical prosody had 27 different meters in it. Rumi expanded it to over 50. So there are a lot of new meters in the poetry of Rumi, which you do not find actually in any of the other great Persian poems, and Persia is very rich in poetry, of course. But it will take a few minutes of your time for those of you who do not understand Persian. I want you to listen to the music more than anything else. چه تدبیر ای مسلمانان که من خود را نمی دانم نه ترسا نه یهودم من نه گبرم نه مسلمانم نه شرقیم نه غربیم نه بریم نه بحریم نه از کان طبیعیم نه از افلاک گردانم نه از خاکم نه از آبم نه از بادم نه از آتش نه از عرشم نه از فرشم نه از کونم نه از کانم نه از هندم، نه از چینم، نه از بلغار و سقسینم، نه از ملک عراقینم، نه از ملک خاک خراسانم نه از دنیا، نه از عقبا، نه از جنت، نه از دوزخ، نه از آدم، نه از حوا، نه از فردوس و رزوانم مکانم لا مکان باشد، نشانم بی نشان باشد، نه تن باشد، نه جان باشد، که من از جان جانانم دویی از خود به در کردم یکی دیدم دو عالم را یکی جویم یکی دانم یکی بینم یکی خانم هو الاول هو الاخر هو الظاهر هو الباطن به جز یا هو یا من هو کسی دیگر نمی دانم ز جام عشق سرمستم دو عالم رفته از دستم به جز رندی و قلاشی نباشد هیچ سامانم اگر در عمر خود روزی دمی بر تو برآوردم از آن وقت و از آن ساعت ز عمر خود پشیمانم اگر دستت دهد روزی دمی با تو در این خلوت دو عالم زیر پای آرم همی دستی برافشانم الا ای شمس تبریزی چنین مستم در این عالم که جز بستی و قلاشی نباشد هیچ دستانم I feel embarrassed translating this poem for you, but this is my own translation, very, very insufficient. What is to be done, O Muslims? For I know myself not. Neither a Christian am I, nor a Jew, nor Magian, nor Muslim. Neither of the East am I, nor West, nor of the land, nor sea. Nor of nature's quarry, nor of heaven circling above. I am not made of earth or water, not of wind or fire, nor am I of the divine throne, nor of the floor carpeting, nor of the domain of the cosmos, nor of minerals. I am not from India, nor China, nor Bulgaria, nor Turkestan, I'm not from the kingdom of the two Iraqs, nor from the earth of Khorasan. Neither of this world I am, nor the next, nor of heaven nor hell, nor from Adam nor Eve, nor of Eden, nor paradise, nor the supreme garden. My place is the placeless. My mark is the markless. Not either body or soul, for I myself, the beloved, am. I cast aside duality, seeking the two worlds as one. I see the one, I know the one, I see the one, seek the one, I call the one. He is the first, he is the last, he is the outward, he is the inward. I know no one other than he, none but he who is he. Drunk with the goblet of love I am. The two worlds have to me been lost. No rest I have but in debauchery, no rest but in drunkenness. If I spent a moment of my life without thee, I regret that moment. I for that hour of my life do repent. If one day I'm given a moment with thee in this spiritual retreat, I shall trample the two worlds underfoot and dance in ecstasy. O Shams of Tabriz, I'm so drunk in this world that but for the drunkenness and the revelry, no story how I to account. Now this is Rumi. This is Rumi. Yeah, you cannot express more universal identity than he does in this incredible ghazal. And this should not be, therefore, identified in any way with parochialism. One of the ways that Rumi can bring us to life, renewal of life in our day and age, is to posit globalism that at the same time does not desecrate the particularity of cultures. All cultures are particular. All languages are particular. In the same way, they cannot have a universal language unless you force one language, like Chinese or English, upon the rest of humanity. But each country has its own language. In the same way, it is with the truth itself. The truth is both universal and it is always, culturally speaking, particular. Now, how to combine, like, the love of humanity with the love of your father and mother? They're particular beings, they're not the whole of humanity. I have to combine the two. It's a very, very difficult task. Very difficult task. And one of the ways that Rumi is able to address one of the primary problems of humanity today is to be able to love the whole without loving the part to which we belong any less. Let me put it this way. And the whole would include everything. All different categories and the part to which we belong, every different category. Now, another aspect of Rumi that is extremely significant that makes him the renewer of life for us is that what he teaches concerns everything. We have two types of great Sufi masters in Islamic history. Those who wrote primarily on very profound metaphysical and philosophical questions, like Ibn Arabi. Ibn Arabi is the great, very great master for the elite. The other were people who were just as profound in their understanding of the truth, but whose vocation was to be able to expand it for everyone. And this was usually done through the language of poetry. One of the greatest achievements of Islamic civilization, not only in Persian, but also Arabic, Turkish, Urdu, other major languages of Islamic civilization, was to be able to create a language which was shared spiritually by the saint and by the beggar in the street, and everyone in between, by the most educated and by the illiterate. Any of you who's lived in the Islamic world, in Iran itself, or Pakistan, India, Arab world, know that oftentimes you find a simple person begging in the street who knows more Sufi poetry than all the professors in Washington put together. That is a very, very common thing. And there was the percolation of the profoundest ideas into simplest forms and into all layers of society was one of the remarkable achievements of Islamic civilization, of Sufism, and particularly of Rumi. I've traveled very extensively in the Islamic world. Except for the Arab world, where Rumi is not well known, Rumi was translated twice, the Masnavi into Arabic. One was shortly after his death, one 700 years later, when Ziba Kalam translated in Iran about 50 years ago. But he's not well known in the Arab world. But in the Turkish world, including all the way to Albania, and of course in Iran and Afghanistan, where the mother tongue is the same as that of Rumi, and all of Central Asia, and all of Muslim India. All of Muslim India, there's no one who has not read something of Rumi, who does not know something of Rumi. I've met beggars, I've told some of my students stories of in the streets of Delhi, who found out I was a Persian, who they would quote Persian poems, despite all the attempts of the British to destroy the Persian language in India. They didn't succeed completely. They did almost, but not completely. So this is universality of the spread of the teachings of Maulana throughout most of the Islamic world. And now, interestingly enough, it's spreading into the Malay world. For the first time, the Masnavi has been translated into Malay. Bahasa Malay is just coming out. Second volume, book two just came out. I wrote a long introduction for the first volume. The first volume is out. And all the six volumes will be out very soon, inshallah. It was a major achievement and unbelievable thirst that exists in the Malay world. Maybe a century from now, the Malay world will be included along with the other worlds as a place where the teachings of Rumi spread. And one of the reasons of this vast spread is that he speaks to all levels of human society. I said, I've had experience in my life when I was a child. My father used to take me to these literary sessions once a week with six or seven of the greatest scholars of Iran at that time, many of whom were prime ministers, head of the parliament, people like that, And he would sit down and he would take me along, my father, 3-4 hours just discussing one verse of Hafiz or Rumi, just one or two verses. And at the same time, the fellow in the street who was selling beets or bread also knew some verse of Rumi. We do not have something like that in the English language. The great metaphysical poets like John Donne, people like that, are not known by the ordinary people. Certainly not in our day and age, when poetry has been forgotten. Perhaps the time of Shakespeare. Shakespeare is the closest to it. Shakespeare is the person who speaks, at least when he wrote his plays. Now, if you speak Shakespeare in English, they think you're putting on an act as a Harvard don or something like that, dean, professor. But in the old days, in the Elizabethan period, that was the closest thing you can find in the English language, and nothing in French, absolutely nothing. France has produced great prose writers, but very few great poets. The greatest poet is Victor Hugo, or Baudelaire, or someone like that. They're fifth-rate Persian poets. I mean, they don't understand. They cannot compare with Hafiz and Maulana, but even coming down the line. So, but English, you have this image of Shakespeare in your mind, that Shakespeare was quoted by the literary figures at Oxford and Cambridge and so forth when this place came out. At the same time, was known to the population, and high school students had to memorize some verses. Now, much less so. And translate the place of Shakespeare into poetry. That's what Rumi is in this Islamic world. That is, he speaks to all levels, and his language is deceivingly simple. Deceivingly simple, because it usually stories. Stories of a parrot, or of a slave girl, or of a king doing this, of a fort, all of these things like that. It seems that simple, but the most profound realities are expressed in it. And it, like a net, it's like that, it's cast into the whole of life. And that this is the aspect of the Masnavi that makes it like the Quran. The famous poem of Abdurrahman Jami said that the spiritual Masnavi of Jalaluddin Rumi is the Quran in the Persian language. Has Quran dar zaban Pahlavi. A remarkable statement to make. Because the Quran, in a sense, is like a net that catches the human being, wherever he is, whoever he is, and drags him towards God without knowing it even. And Masnavi is like that also. It speaks about all kinds of things, all kinds of people. But everything is imbued with the sacred, with the sense of the sacred. And so it's a net of the sacred cast into the world. And that's what has made him such a universal figure throughout Islamic history. And this is one of the reasons that unconsciously so many people are attracted to Rumi today. We live in a world that is desacralized. The sacred is forgotten. And the role of modernism is to vacuum clean whatever remains of the sacred. Mirshay Eliade in his book The Sacred and the Profane was quite right. He said modernism will not stop until it's destroyed all that is sacred. That's what modernism does. But it's not going to succeed because the sacred is the nature of reality. And the yearning for the sacred remains in us even if we have rejected the sacred. It is that yearning that attracts so many people to the Masnavi and the other poetry of Rumi. It's something that's missing in us that finds fulfillment in it without being able to define in our mind what we mean by the sacred. Another very important aspect of Rumi's teachings, which are important for the renewal of life, is the language of Rumi. Rumi wrote a few prose works. The most important is a book called Fihi Ma Fi. The title is in Arabic, and it means in it is what is in it. Fihi Ma Fi. And it's been translated into English by Arbery as the Discourses as a second translation. It's a table talks of Rumi. And then they have the seven majalis, Saba Majalis, which is in Arabic, and a few letters which Rumi wrote in Persian. The rest of his production is all poetry. Now, this is one of the very remarkable phenomena. Rumi began his life as a religious scholar. He didn't write any poetry. He wrote prose. He taught at the madrasa. He was both a theologian. He was also a member of Tasawwuf already. He received the Sufism from his father, Al-Din Balad. Not later on. The other masters came later, but he received it from his father. But he did not write any poetry until this great transformation came over him and is symbolized by the presence of Shams Tabrizi, an enigmatic figure who is both a human being and a function, a spiritual function in his life. I'm not going to talk about Shams at all. My former student, a brilliant scholar, William Chittick, has written a book called Shams and Me, and it is a very, very good book. If you want to read something about Shams, you should read that book, an extensive book that came out last year. I'm not going to talk about Shams, but Shams symbolizes also. It's not only a human being, symbolizes a spiritual function into which I will not go. But once that came into his life, as I've said elsewhere in one of my writings in Rumi, it was like a meteor coming close to Earth. It causes tidal waves, waves in the ocean. This meteor came close to Rumi, and it caused these tidal waves, which came out in the form of poetry. So he never considered himself to be a poet. And he always, in a very famous poem of Rumi, says, Haft shahr ishq ra attar gash ma hanuzam dar kham yek kuchein. That is, Fareddin Attar, the great Sufi poet, the Horem, had traversed the seven cities of love. We're still stuck at the bent of the first street. In all humility, he didn't even consider himself to be a poet. He was a poet in spite of himself. But his soul was rhythmic. I mean, an unbelievable sensitivity to both poetry and music. It is said that in the old days, I will tell this story, Persians used to wear oftentimes shoes, so did the Turks, that had wood underneath rather than leather. The heels were made of wood. I would go to bathhouses in Iran even today. And so it made some noise. And the stairs were pretty tall in those days. When Rumi would go from the first stair to the second, third step going up to the second floor, the very sound of the shoe that would make him tap, 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 would put him into a hal, would put him in a spiritual state. He would just go into another world for a long, long time. He was that sensitive to beauty, to the beauty of sound, and to the beauty of rhythm, because his soul was already in rhythm, the divine rhythm. And so everything that came out of it, that soul, was in the form of poetry, in the deepest sense. And therefore, he was able to mold the Persian language in such a way that the poetry was able to express everything that needs to be expressed really for the spiritual life. I consider the greatest Persian poet not to be Rumi, but to be Hafez, a spiritual poet. I'm unbelievable, as a divine poet, really. is not human almost. But Hafez does not speak in the same way that Rumi does. Rumi speaks to almost everyone. There's nothing, no one on the surface of the earth to whom one of the lines of Rumi will not have some meaning someday in life. I've never met anyone if they were only to find out. And so this language itself makes it accessible. If Rumi had produced Ibn Arabi 500 major books in Arabic in prose, he probably would not have been as popular as he is today. It's this ocean of poetry, and now a mind by people who don't know even Persian. Most of the famous translators of Rumi in English today don't know Persian. I don't want to name any names, but none of them knows Persian well. And they usually get help from some Afghan or Persian, and then they render into, or take the Nicholson translation of the Masnavi, which is prose, which is not poetry, and then turn it into poetry, English poetry, or American poetry, I'd like to call it. Now, before the world comes to an end, I have to end my talk, and I want to turn now to something very important spiritually, and that is that Rumi's poetry, and through the poetry, a spiritual presence that exists in it, are very, very important, of course, for the renewal of life on the individual level, not the social, on the individual level. I'll talk about the social level in a moment. From a spiritual point of view, no society can have its life renewed unless the life of the individual is renewed. Renewal always begins inwardly, with us. In the same way that every step we take in every direction has to be from where we are. I cannot take a step from the other side of the room because I'm standing here. Whether I want to go this way or this way, I have to start from where we are. We have no choice but to start from where we are. And therefore, who we are, and try to discover who we are. And so the most important message of Rumi for the renewal of life is the renewal of the life of the individual, of course. Now, here, there's so much to say, but I have to be very short. I want to, first of all, remove a very major error that exists in the study of Rumi today, not only in America, but also among a lot of Persians and Turks and others who consider Rumi as a kind of nationalistic emblem. Rumi was a Muslim. He was a Muslim poet. He never missed his prayers. He said, "Aghla kuntu fadaya Mustafa," sacrifice your intellect at the feet of the Prophet. And the Masnavi is a Quranic commentary, it's a commentary on the Quran. He knew the Quran extremely well. And at the beginning of the Masnavi, which is in Arabic, not in English, he says this remarkable sentence. He said, "This book is Hadha al-Kitab, usul al-usul 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 al-din," is the principle of the principle of the principle of the principle of religion. Fi ahkam al-yaqeen and other things that come afterwards. So it's very, very clear that this work is dealing with the heart of religion. There's no secular Rumi, which is authentic. You cannot have this in one sentence: authenticity, secularity, and Rumi. You cannot Rumi secularized. Everything in our world is secularized. Even the Virgin is secularized in some form of Christianity and the art and so forth that goes with it, with her, her iconography. That's the West is a secularized place. Everything that comes in there is secularized. There's no doubt about it. But it cannot preserve its authenticity. And everything in the West is not completely secularized. There are things which are not secularized. There's the Catholic Church, there are other Christian denomination, their practices, the Judaism, all kinds of religions still survive in the West despite everything. In order to understand Rumi, you must understand that he was not a New Age poet. He was not born in California. And he does not represent what we're looking for, a kind of bland, sentimental, let's love each other, universality in which you don't have to do anything either for yourself. For God, or to correct yourself. You don't have to reform ourselves, we just get together and be happy. He's not that kind of poet at all, and you must understand that. And the relation of Rumi with Islam, once severed, will make Rumi irrelevant as a spiritual therapy. A spiritual therapy. Because there's a secret also to Rumi, and that is that Rumi is one of the very few Sufi masters who's able to guide beyond the grave. It's a very, very esoteric aspect of his teaching. Probably none of you have ever heard about it, what I'm talking about, but there are few in this class, in this room who do. But there's spiritual guidance in Sufism. The spiritual guidance always emanates from God and the Prophet, the power of it, the possibility of it. And usually when a master dies, that is finished. There are few people in the Islamic world to whom God has given this power of guiding beyond the grave. And one of them is Rumi, Jalaluddin Rumi. And many people in Turkey go to his tomb. Another one is, another context, is the 8th Shiite Imam, Ali al-Reda, Imam Reza in Khorasan, who is called the Imam of Initiation. And people go there for spiritual guidance of a man who died 1100 years ago at the time of Mamun, at the beginning of the Abbasid period. But anyway, it's very, very important to realize that all of the message of Rumi, everything that he wrote, it's just in order for us to remember God, to bring us to God. And he has so many poems about this. And the main goal of it is the inner transformation. He always faces with the fact that we're going to die, that this life is a short life, that while we are alive, let us seek the eternal life, which knows no death. I mean, there's so many beautiful poems. The one which I quote so often, but I quote it for you again here, is a robe mire khaje qabl az mordanat ta nabashad zahmat jan dadanat. Anchanan margi ke dar nuri ravi, ne chanan margi ke dar guri ravi. O master, go and die before you die. It's of course hadith of the Prophet, mutu qabl anta mutu. The Prophet said, die before you die. And he puts in Persian poem. So that when you die, you will not suffer the pain of death. Die such a death that you will go unto light. Not the death that will lead you to the grave. Rumi always talks about this. You cannot study Rumi without understanding the spiritual significance of death, that is death to the lower self, and the resurrection of what is within us, the renewal of life in the real sense. Now, on the social level also, Rumi, of course, has a great deal to provide for us, but not in America so much, because there's no organization. But if you look at the history of the Islamic world, the role played by the Molavi order in the Ottoman Empire is really unbelievable. First of all, two of the Ottoman sultans were members of the Molavi order. Many of the viziers and the grand viziers and generals and so forth and so on, they belonged to the order. They were so powerful that when Kemal Atatürk came to power, in order to break the power of religion in Turkey, the first thing they did was to ban the Molavis before any other order, before the Rafa'is, the Qadiris, anybody else. He banned the Molavi order, and many of their sheikhs were put to death in prison in ways which have never been told in public, but great tragedies. It's now opening up again a little bit in Turkey. They're beginning to function. But it played a very important social role that Rumi did. This is important to understand, very, very important to understand in our day and age. Some people identify efficacy with only its social aspect. A person is important who has a social function. Some people just the other way. But in fact, this depends on one's vocation. There are people whose presence in the world is invisible. All saints, in a sense, play a role in preserving the equilibrium of the world, even if they're not known. Others whose function, whose presence is visible. And Rumi was one of the people who was very visible. He created one of the most important and powerful Sufi orders in the history of Islam, which had disciples from Albania to Tunisia, going on the other side of the Mediterranean Sea. And thousands upon thousands of people were followers, and the tariqah was decimated in 1924 when it was banned by the new Turkish parliament after the fall of the caliphate or sultanate, Ottoman world. And it's underground to some extent, but it still survives. And they still have disciples also in Macedonia, in Albania, all kinds of places. Anyway, the important thing to realize is that for Rumi, as a very good model, The effect of human beings in this world is not an either-or matter, that either the primacy of the individual or the primacy of society. They go together. They go together and depends on one's vocation. The important thing is to see what God wants of us, what He wants us to do, but not exclude either side, one side or the other. It's amazing how a man like Rumi, who never created a political party, who never ran for office, you might say in the modern sense that didn't try to join a government, he had more power than many kings did. His tariqah, the tariqah Maulaviya, the role it played in the 700 years of Ottoman history, 600 years of Ottoman history, is absolutely amazing. So this is also, we talk about renewal of life on a social level. We live in such abysmal times, politically and socially, when there's so much hypocrisy that goes on in the world. It's unbelievable already, it's sickening. The lesson of a person like Rumi and the heritage that he left behind on the macro scale, on the social scale, I think is also very, very important. Now, my time is coming to an end, and I want to conclude fairly soon. I want to talk about three other very important points of Rumi, which are important for the renewal of life in our day and age, in the deepest sense. One is beauty. I just mentioned that Rumi was so sensitive to rhythm and music that he would go into a hall, a spiritual state, by just walking up the stairs, but just the rhythm, like a flamenco dancer tapping her feet on the ground, just the rhythm of the shoe on the ground. Now, Rumi is in many ways the supreme troubadour of beauty, because he, more than anyone else, not only emphasized beauty in his poetry, but also the sama, the Rumi, the Maulavi whirling dervishes dance that you have all seen pictures of or seen in films and things like that, which is one of the most beautiful forms of sacred art of this kind in the Islamic world, were actually due to him. And everything he did was very beautiful, all those who were around him. In a sense, of course, every saint has to be beautiful, has to have a beautiful soul in order to be saintly. But Rumi emphasized especially the significance of beauty, the therapeutic significance of beauty, that beauty heals the soul. Beauty heals. And there are so many different aspects. For example, he has some of the most beautiful poems about music. Music is one of the most inward arts that takes us right to the divine empyrean, especially classical Persian and Turkish music, which is deeply inspired by classical Persian music, which is really not a social music, a military music, it's interiorized, totally interiorized music, which you're going to hear in a few minutes, inshallah. And he goes to the point of, in one of the most remarkable poems I've ever read, he addresses God and he says, "Mocha changi motona khan mizani." We are like the harp, and thou art the one who plucks the harp. That is, we are ourselves the instruments in God's hands. What we do, what we say, what we think, should be like music, not like cacophony. Unfortunately, most of us don't live up to that. But Rumi was very, very much aware of this, of this sense of beauty, of ihsan. And as you know, in Arabic and Persian, you have this remarkable word, husn, which means both goodness and beauty. There's these two very different concepts which have been debated about so much in the history of ethics, philosophy of ethics in the West, beauty versus ethics versus aesthetics. In Arabic, they're the same, really. The word is the same, husn and ihsan. My own name comes from that. It's a new name that did not exist in Arabic, and the Prophet gave to his younger grandson. The name Hussein became, but it comes from the same root. Hassan, Hussein, Hussein, Hassan, they're all the same roots. And that was the heart of Rumi's message. The fourth point that I want to mention is that there is no possibility of the renewal of life intellectually without inward knowledge. It's possible to renew life ethically, artistically, morally, socially. But intellectually, there has to be a renewal on the highest level, the intellect. what we call esoteric knowledge, inward knowledge. And in the modern study of Rumi, that is almost completely overlooked. Almost completely overlooked. Whereas the Masnavi of Rumi is a treasury of esoteric knowledge. It's called Bahr-e Ma'rifat in Persian, the ocean of Gnosis. Oh, there's a great troubadour of love, it's called the ocean of Gnosis. Bahr-e Ma'rifat. And it's remarkable how many pearls there are in that sea, if you can only learn how to dive for it, how to bring out the pearl in the deep meanings. It's just unbelievable, it's inexhaustible, absolutely inexhaustible, the amount of depth of knowledge that is contained in the Masnavi. And finally, I want to end with this. My time is also up. Of course, Rumi has been called, above everything else, the great poet of love, the troubadour of love. And he certainly is that. But we must understand that love, ishq, which is common between Arabic and Persian, is not meant as sentimental emotion. It's very, very important to understand that. Some of you are scholars here, know, but some of you probably do not know. The word ishq, I-S-H-Q or E-S-H-Q in Persian, it comes from a plant, a vine, that wrapped itself around trees and pressed so much until it killed the tree. See how beautiful this is. Ishq is that which kills us. Love, real love, is what kills. It kills the lower self, for the only love that there really is the love of the truth, of God. Everything that we love is ultimately the love of God without our knowing it. Even the most worldly person is really looking for that love, but looking in the wrong place. And of course, Rumi spent all of his life speaking about this. His being was full of love, and he was able to explain the hierarchy of love, that there's no such thing as purely human love, purely divine love, purely worldly life, purely spiritual life. They're all part of the scale of the same thing, in like levels of light. Any love is ultimately a little ray of the love of God, ultimately, which is the highest form of love. And so Rumi, at the beginning of the Masnavi, exalts love, and in a remarkable way. And I want to conclude my talk with just citing that for you. Many of you know that this poem, or is a very ecstatic two verses at the beginning of the Masnavi. It says, "Shad bash, ay ishq por sodai ma." ای طبیب جمله علتهای ما ای دوای نخوت و ناموس ما ای تو افلاطون و جالینوس ما. I think everything of Rumi is contained in these two verses. Let me translate it for you. I might break my pen to translate something like this. Hail to thee. I translate Shadbash, hail to thee. Be happy. Hail to thee. O our love with goodly passion. O physician of all our ailments, O remedy of our pride and honor, O thou, our Plato and Galen besides. May the love abide with all of you, and especially this new year, renew your life in every way. Thank you.